How terrible. Faith to faith. Old Testament and New, and this right here tells you that. The destroyer sees the blood. Well, somebody had to have faith to put the blood out in the first place. Okay? The blood isn't what saves them. It's the faith of actually doing it. Yes?
They were saved by the faith instead of the blood.
Right.
Would he be able to tell if the Egyptians put blood up there?
See, that is one thing. It doesn't make a distinction. And it does say that a mixed multitude went out with the people. So I'm telling you that I believe that the people that lived around the Jewish people, whether they were Hyksos or whether they were Egyptians or whatever, they said to their neighbor, put blood on your lintel and you will be saved. And I guarantee you that they were. It doesn't say it explicitly, but I do believe that no matter who it was, no matter who it was, if they did it by faith, yeah, we're going to put this. Why would we put lamb's blood on our lintel? You know, and most of the people, if there's 603,550 males in the Israelite community, only the leaders had the information as to why they were doing. The rest of the people are saying, okay, they're just doing it because they're told and they're doing it by faith, right? And then the neighbors see it. What are you doing? Well, we're told that our firstborn won't die if we put this up. Oh, let me do that, right? If God is merciful, maybe he won't do it to me. It's always faith. And yeah, I do believe that. It doesn't say it explicitly, but anybody that comes under the blood is going to be safe. I believe that because that's the nature of God. He wants us to believe that what he says is true. I'm going to destroy you if you don't do this. Okay, then I'll do it. Or I will give you sons as many as the stars in the sky. And Abraham says, okay. And God says he's righteous because of that one act. That's what God wants, is for us to simply have faith that when he speaks, it's true. And that's why this is so hugely precious, is because I believe that he has spoken. I've said this, and I know maybe even some people in here will disagree with me, but I don't believe in extra biblical revelation as the word of God. That doesn't mean that people don't get, I quoted a guy named Malachi in the Sunday class a while ago, and he had a list of the popes to the very last pope. And that could be true. But it is not extra biblical revelation that saves us. It's just simply God telling something is going to happen and, you know, kind of keep your eye out for it. But I believe that this right here, this book and nothing else, is what we need to be saved. And I don't mean that this saves us. The Bible doesn't save us. It's what is in the Bible that saves us. The message of God, and by faith we receive this. And the more that we receive it, the more we study it. That's why I'm always so happy to see people in Bible studies, is because they are really getting the depth of God. They are really getting into it, whether it's this study or, you know, wherever, whoever does a Bible study. If they're really studying it based on what God is telling them, you are increasing your faith. Why else would you be here? Right? I mean, what else is the point of being in Bible study except to know God and to know what he wants for us to do with our lives? I don't know. But yeah, I do. That's a really good question, because I really believe those people. And you'll see it says a mixed multitude went out with them, and we're getting up to that. Yeah, maybe today we'll get to it. Okay, go ahead. Next verse. Are you leaving? Boy, that mother. Oh, my goodness. Love you.
Love you too.
When you enter the land that the Lord will give you, as he promised, you are to observe this ritual. When your children ask you, what does this ritual mean to you? You are to reply, it is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord, for he passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and spared our homes. So the people bowed down and worshiped.
Yay.
Then the Israelites went and did this. They did this just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron.
So they were obedient. They did just what they were told. They said, okay, God says it's going to happen. We're going to do it. And the children asked the question, and that goes on today. In the Passover ceremony, the children asked the question, Daddy, why do we do this? And it's a whole ceremony. It's all written out. Why do we do this? Because at this time this happened. At this time this happened. They go through this long, night-long ceremony, year after year after year. Unfortunately, they don't see where it all ends. All they see is that it points back to something in the past, but they don't see that it really has an end in Jesus. If they did, you know, if the light bulb would come on, they understand already these things, is what I'm getting at. And that's why Paul uses in Romans chapter 9 or 11, he talks about the olive tree. Do you know that one that he's talking about? Let me read it to you, because Paul makes a point about when the Jewish people finally realize who their Messiah is. He makes a really wonderful comparison. He says that we are, think of the covenant people as an olive tree. Whoops, I'm going backwards, not forwards. Get to Romans, and I think it's in 11 that he finishes it, but it might be in 9. Okay, here it is. It's 11. It says here, speak to you Gentiles. I'm going to start with 11:15. For if they're being cast away, meaning the Jewish people, they've been cast away because of disobedience and unbelief in Jesus. If they're being cast away as the reconciling of the world, that means that the world is reconciled to God through Christ because the Jews were cast away. If they had accepted Jesus Christ as their Messiah, the kingdom age would have been ushered in immediately, and we would not be saved right now. This was all part of God's greater plan, was that the Jews would be cast off so that the Gentiles would be grafted in. Here's what it says. If being cast away is reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? That tells me right there, the Jewish people, when they call on Jesus as the Messiah, is the time of the resurrection. And that's right in the end of the book of the tribulation says that the dead will come to life and blah, blah, blah. There you go. Anyway, so when they accept Christ as the Messiah at that time, that's when the resurrection will happen. For if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. So he's saying, here's a tree. Here's an olive tree. Okay? And it is holy. The branches are in the tree, therefore they are holy, right? Verse 17, he says, and if some of the branches were broken off, that's the Jewish people, and you being a wild olive were grafted in among them, and with them became a partaker of the root and fatness of the tree. Here we have, here's what he's saying here. I don't want to lose that page. Okay, we've got olive tree. If you've ever seen an olive tree, they're really neat. They got these giant bases on them, just huge. You go to the ones in Israel at the Garden of Garden of Gethsemane. These things are 2,000 years old. They've been there since way back. Okay, you're not allowed to pick any leaves off of them. Why would they say that?
Because it would die.
Well, is it going to harm if I pull off one leaf?
But if everybody goes and does it.
Good point. Most people don't think that through. Yeah, 50,000 visitors a year in there. You're going to kill the thing. So nobody's allowed to pick off a leaf. And you see people do it anyway, like, hello. Anyway, he's saying this branch is Jewish. This is the natural olive tree, right? And we're going to break off these branches. These are Jews that are being broken off. And then we have another olive tree over here, which is a wild one. It's not cultivated. This is a nice cultivated tree, and this one is wild. It's got all these crazy branches all over. Wait, he says, we're going to break off this branch and put it into this holy stump. That's us being grafted in to what we're talking about right now. The law, understanding all of these pictures of Christ, everything is coming right here. We're going to graft them into here. This will work. Even though it's contrary to nature, we can graft this into here. If you go to Home Depot and you buy a lemon tree, are you buying a grafted tree or are you buying a natural tree?
Grafted.
Definitely grafted, because if it's natural, it's going to have thorns all over it and the fruit is going to be crummy. The Japanese are the ones, anytime you buy a citrus, it's always called something japonica. The reason why is because the Japanese are the ones that did the hundreds or even thousands of years of grafting to make the citrus the way they are. All of that effort. So, anyway, he says that if this works, how much more when we take these real branches, the Jewish people, pick them up off the ground and shove them into this tree. That is going to take so much easier than this. Because we're wild. We don't know all of this symbolism from the Old Testament. We don't know it. But we fit into the tree anyway. But if this guy that knows all of this symbolism, his whole life, 65 years old, he's been doing the Passover year after year, he's been celebrating the Feast of Trumpets, and they just do this. You know, the Festival of Hanukkah, they read the Hanukkah stuff, and they understand it, but they don't know what it points to. You put it into that tree, and all of a sudden, it's like they take to it. They understand everything already that we have to really struggle to understand because we're wild. We don't know what God has done in the Old Testament. They have it in their life. They've got it in their culture. They've got it in their history. They've got it, everything. That's what Paul is saying right here, is that this olive tree is going to be regrafted in, and they have all of this knowledge that we are studying right now. It's already in their head. They will take so quickly when they are grafted back in, and that's going to happen. Very soon, Israel's back in the land. We're going to be out of here. They're going to go through tribulation, and they're going to call on Jesus, and it is going to happen like that. Let it happen today. Woo.
Thank you,
yes.
I know how you're always quoting, and this is one of my favorite ones too, about how nothing new has ever happened.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Before it will happen again.
Right.
we're very sure of the rapture, but so were the ones in the first century. And we're very sure, that doesn't mean it's not going to just keep on going.
Well, that's true, but what I always say, and you're right, and I think, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself with that, but what is the difference between now and the first century?
Israel.
Israel. That is the difference. And they are back after being punished seven times over for their sins. As a matter of fact, I quoted exactly that last night. They are back in the land. And this was all part of God's providence. And like I said, the way that I'm sure that this is true is because they were blinded in part so that the Gentiles could come into the fold, right? He uses that exact terminology. They were blinded. Spiritual blindness has come to Israel, right? Now they are starting to do what? In huge numbers, they're starting to call on Jesus as their Messiah. And like I said, you've got a pane of glass. This is why I believe we are really close. And I know what you're saying. I don't disagree with it at all. But here we've got a pane of glass, and it's kind of wobbly, so you can't see through it well, right? And we're trying to look through here, and we don't see. We'll say this is the Jews, and they're trying to look through the glass and say, all paths lead to God, and whatever they think, you know, they just see everything kind of, because they're blinded. God has said they're blinded. They can't see that Jesus is on the other side, okay? And this is what Paul's talking about in Romans 9 through 11. Jesus is right over here, but they can't see it. God has partially blinded them. But we are on the side of Jesus, right? Here we are. We'll say this is us, and we'll even make a little happy smile, because what's the problem with us?
Well, we're kind of
we're on this side, and we can't see that God, in fact, has a plan for the Jews. Do you see what I'm saying? And so for the past 2,000 years, the church has said, Jews aren't anything. They're out. They're out completely. And all of a sudden, what's happening? This is starting to get a little less wobbly. And we're seeing, back in the 1800s, we are seeing there's a plan for the Jews after all. John Darby comes out and he comes up with dispensationalism. What are you talking about? And you got all the old churches that refuse to even open their eyes, and they say, nope, Jews are out. They're totally out. But every year, year after year after year, it gets a little bit less wobbly. It's a little clearer. And we are seeing, look at, Israel has won 3 impossible wars. Israel has actually anointed the cornerstone for the temple. Israel has all of the implements for the temple. There's not going to be a temple ever. And all of a sudden we say, well, Revelation 11 says, yeah, go measure the temple. Well, we're the temple. How do you measure people? All of a sudden you say, it's got to be literal. And so the world really is, I do believe, we are starting to see that there is a plan for the Jews, just like they are starting to come to Jesus. And there's a point where it's just going to happen. And that's called
rapture.
I really think so. I could be totally wrong. I could be totally wrong on this.
I'm not disagreeing with you. Yeah. I'm just saying.
We have been saying this.
We've always been saying this.
I agree. I say the same thing to myself. I say, Lord, it could be another 1,000 years. I have to kick myself and say, you know, I don't want to get people too excited. But we're here. We're right there.
What makes us live for the moment.
Oh, yeah.
Redeem the time, right?
Oh, yeah. Because if we're just, it's not going to happen, why would we even bother? Somebody else will take care of it. But I really think that we are very close.
And that's why the early church was so fervent.
Yeah, because they thought.
And that's why today there's much more fervency.
That's right, because we're starting to see what the early church, what was the last thing they said before Jesus ascended? Are you going at this time to reestablish the kingdom or establish the kingdom in Israel or whatever? And he says, it's not for you to know. But now we're starting to see the Jews are back in the land. All of the, and like I said, Hal Lindsey in 1980, whatever, 5 we'll say, was called a false prophet because he said the European Union is going to be reestablished. And they said, that'll never happen. He is a false prophet. And within 20 years, he's laughing at those people because he believes the Bible in a dispensationalist sense. And all these people that just can't, they're still standing there looking at the dark, dark glass, just like the Jews that won't accept Jesus. But eventually, it starts to clear up. And I really think we're close. You know, I thought we were close in 2005. So, you know, I was wrong. But we're 6 years closer than we were. That's right. And I got a lot more gray in my beard. But I tell you, I'm still waiting.